Welcome to the online worship service of Triumph Lutheran Brethren Church. Triumph is a multi-site church in the Midwest with campuses in Moorhead, Minnesota and West Fargo, North Dakota. Our vision is to see the life and message of Jesus transform hearts, homes, and cities. We're grateful that you've joined us online as the Lord works through our ministry both locally and around the world. Wherever you are at, our prayer is that God would meet you and that the life and message of Jesus would transform your life.
Love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away. Wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice called out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Today's psalm is a real mystery. Psalm 22 is incredibly mysterious because Psalm 22 is a psalm of David, right? It is. King David wrote this. And what did he write about? Just listen again to some of the things that David says is happening to him. Verses 6 and 7, David writes about being publicly scorned and despised and mocked and insulted. People are shaking their heads at him. That's SMH for all you oldsters out there. Verses 12 to 18, David says that he's surrounded by bulls and roaring lions and wild dogs and villains. He says he's being poured out like water, melted like wax. His mouth is all dried up like a potsherd, which I looked it up and is a dried out piece of pottery that's dug out of the sand. Dry sandpaper. So dry and thirsty that his tongue is choking him. He's so malnourished that you can see his bones, every one of them. He's been pierced in his hands and feet by a sword or a spear or something. What's happening to him? It sounds like he's being murdered in public. This is an execution, he's describing, a public execution. The clincher is verse 18, where it says, they cast lots for my garments. Because back then, when a criminal was executed, the executioners got the clothes. So David is describing his public execution. When did that happen? I mean, we probably know more about King David's life than we know about literally any other person in ancient history, and there's nothing about this anywhere. King David was never publicly tried and executed. This is a real mystery, because it's actually not even historically possible. Because back then, if you overthrow a king, you know, you don't give him a public trial and a judge and a jury and that kind of thing. You just kill him. You get rid of him and his family, and you just take over and sit on the throne yourself. So, in other words, then, not only did this never happen to David, but it couldn't have happened to David. And that's not the only mystery here. It's not the only mystery that King David was treated like this. It's also a mystery that King David let himself be treated like this. Because if you know anything about King David, you know that he never took any kind of injustice lying down. I mean, we see this all over the Psalms. David's always crying out for justice. He's asking God to do things like smash people's teeth. Stuff like that. Have you ever read Psalm 109? Oof. I mean, Psalm 109, that's a doozy. Here's just a few of the things that King David asked God to do to his enemies, to the people who are threatening him in Psalm 109. David says, may their days be few. May their children be fatherless, wandering beggars. May creditors take everything they have, and may their mother's sins never be forgiven. I mean, ew, David, mothers and children? Mothers and children are usually off limits. Not for David's enemies, evidently. And in case you're wondering, ain't nobody preaching on Psalm 109 this summer. And there's none of this here, none of this harsh stuff here in Psalm 22, even though David this is probably the most threatening situation that we read about in the Psalms, maybe the most extreme case of injustice in the Psalms. David doesn't say one word about smashing people's teeth or God cursing mothers and children, things like that. Why? Why is there nothing like that here in Psalm 22? It's a real mystery. First, that King David was treated like this, and it's maybe an even bigger mystery that King David allowed himself to be treated like this without saying a word. It's a real mystery. But you know something? Maybe the biggest mystery of all is how this psalm ends. Because in verse 22, all of a sudden, I mean, King David sort of shifts gears here, and he's basically saying, God has listened to my cries for help. God has answered my cries for help, delivered me from death, delivered me from this public execution. And then David starts talking about what's going to happen as a result of God's delivering him from death. Verse 27, he says, All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. Essentially, David says, I was about to be executed here, but God delivered me from death, and because of that, all the nations of the earth will get converted. The poor nations will praise the Lord. Verse 26, the rich nations will worship the Lord. Verse 29, David's basically saying that as a result of my deliverance, instead of one little nation called Israel worshiping the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all the nations of the earth will worship the Lord. And if that isn't wild enough, David says that all future generations to come will remember this deliverance. What? None of this ever happened to David. He was never rescued from being publicly tried and executed. The whole world never worshiped the Lord. And all generations don't remember this because it never happened. You see what a mystery this is? I mean, Psalm 22, on the face of it, is an absolute enigma. It's an incredible mystery. And honestly, I have no idea whatsoever, no idea how in the world the original hearers, the people who first read and heard this psalm like 3,000 years ago now, I have no idea how people back in King David's day would have read and understood this. I have no clue. This is a real mystery. So what's the solution? Is there a solution? Can this mystery be solved? Yeah, it can. But there's only one solution that I know of. There's only one way to make any sense whatsoever out of the psalm, and that's to believe what the Apostle Peter said in Acts chapter 2, verse 31. He said, King David was a prophet, and he foresaw and spoke of Jesus Christ. In some mysterious way, by the power of the Holy Spirit, David was given prophetic insight, where in his mind's eye, he saw beyond himself, somehow saw a greater king who actually would face a public trial and execution, who actually would feel the forsakenness of God, who actually would be delivered from death. A true, better, ultimate king with a truly everlasting kingdom. David was a prophet, and when he wrote Psalm 22, he foresaw and spoke of Jesus Christ. And you know what? Jesus also understood Psalm 22 this way, that Psalm 22 was about him. Because when Jesus Christ was on the cross, probably the most threatening and intense and climactic moment in his life, Jesus cried out in a loud voice the words of Psalm 22, the first words of Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? And remember, back in those days, they didn't have chapter numbers in their Bibles, okay? That didn't happen until the late 1400s, early 1500s or something like that. Before that, they didn't have verses and numbers. And so, they didn't even have titles for books. So the way that you referred to a book or a chapter was you quoted the first words of it. So if you were, in a Bible study, someone would say, hey, would you turn to my God, why have you forsaken me? And David, would you read that for us? So when Jesus cried out Psalm 22 on the cross, the first verse, he was basically saying, this psalm is about me. And it's talking about what's happening to me right now. Or in other words, there is absolutely no possible way to make any sense out of Psalm 22 unless you understand that it's about Jesus Christ. And you will only be able to make sense about Jesus Christ if you understand Psalm 22. Because Psalm 22 tells us, first of all, it tells us how terribly Jesus suffered. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? The original New Testament language where this is recorded actually says that Jesus screamed it. In some places, this word is also translated as roared. And when he did, when Jesus roared from the cross, this meant that something especially terrible was happening. Because up to that point, all kinds of terrible things had been happening to Jesus, and he hadn't said a word. He'd been flogged and beaten and mocked. He'd had long thorns jammed into his head. He had iron spikes driven through his hands and his feet, and through all of it, through every single excruciating moment, Jesus never said a thing. He just quietly took it. All that suffering, all that pain, and he never said a word. Somehow he could take it. But then suddenly he screams, he roars. And that means something, some kind of agony, some kind of pain he couldn't take. Beyond the physical, beyond the beatings, beyond the thorns, beyond the nails. This is something that goes far beyond all that. Because he doesn't scream, my hands, he doesn't roar, my feet, or my head, no. He screams, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus is experiencing something infinitely worse than the agonizing physical suffering. This is a whole new level of suffering here. Cosmic forsakenness, infinite abandonment, metaphysical separation from God. And if we had a bazillion years, I don't think we would ever understand that. I don't think we ever really will understand that. But we do understand, I think, that we're made for relationships. I mean, the Bible's pretty clear on that too, that we're made for relationships, which means then that, you know, as bad as it is to lose things, you know, like your life savings or to lose your pension or even to lose your health, as bad as that is, it's nothing like losing someone you love. It's nothing like losing the love of your life. I mean, we've all heard these just tragic, gut-wrenching, heartbreaking stories of someone losing their spouse after a lifetime together. And then like a week later or something, the other spouse just up and dies, basically of a broken heart. The counselors, psychologists will tell us that there's nothing more devastating than losing the love of your life. But look at Jesus. I mean, his relationship with the Father, this isn't just a 30, 40, or 50-year love relationship. Jesus and the Father have loved one another from all eternity. These aren't just two people becoming one flesh, as powerful as that is. With Jesus and the Father, I mean, they've been one with each other in ways that are infinitely beyond our ability to grasp or even imagine. And they've been one like this for all eternity. We know the agony of losing human love, but we can't imagine the pain of losing what Jesus lost. When Jesus Christ lost the Father's presence, At that instant, for the very first time in all eternity, God the Son looks for God the Father, and he's not there. Jesus was alone in a way that he'd never been before. The Son, who lived completely and utterly for the Father in ways that we'll never grasp, lost him. And Jesus cried out in a loud voice. He screams, he roars, my God, why have you forsaken me? No one ever has or ever will suffer like Jesus. And yet in the face of such soul-crushing suffering, Jesus remained faithful. Because when Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Do you know what it means for him to say, my God? What it meant to Jesus? When Jesus said, my God, it means intimacy. Because we do the same kind of thing. I mean, if you're talking to someone and they say, oh, that's my Carrie. Or, oh, yeah, that's my Mark. You might not know anything about them, except you do know that Carrie or Mark must be one of their kids or their wife or their husband or someone very close and special to them, because when you say my, it means intimacy. So in the midst of this soul-crushing suffering, Jesus is still saying, my God. Please don't miss this. Here is Jesus Christ, who is literally being tortured to death, who's experiencing cosmic forsakenness, infinite abandonment, and metaphysical separation from the Father, and Jesus responds to this by saying, you know what he says? He says, you're still my God. I still love you. You're still my Father God. I'm still faithful to you. You are still mine. Jesus looks around at a universe in which every single trace of God the Father seems to have disappeared and asks why he has been forsaken and still trusts and obeys. There's no greater faithfulness than that. Psalm 22 shows us that. It shows us Jesus' great faithfulness in the face of terrible suffering. And it's this great faithfulness in the midst of terrible suffering, this results in a marvelous salvation. This is how 1 Peter chapter 2 puts it. And I've always loved how Eugene Peterson translates this in the Message. So let me read that for you. Jesus never did one thing wrong. Not once said anything amiss. They called him every name in the book, and he said nothing back. He suffered in silence, content to let God set things right. He used his servant body to carry our sins to the cross so we could be rid of sin, free to live the right way. His wounds became your healing. You were lost sheep with no idea who you were or where you were going, but now you are named and kept for good by the shepherd of your souls. That's ultimately why Jesus remained faithful in the face of such terrible suffering. For you, for me, to carry all our sins to the cross so that we could be rid of sin and free to live the right way, so that we could be named as children of God and kept forever by the shepherd of our souls. if you're familiar with Mark Twain's novel, Tom Sawyer, You might remember the part where Becky Thatcher, who's the girl that Tom Sawyer has a crush on, the part where Becky Thatcher finds their teacher's special hidden book. It's probably my favorite part of the whole story because Tom and Becky's teacher is Mr. Dobbins, okay? And Mr. Dobbins never really wanted to be a teacher. He always wanted to be a doctor, but he couldn't afford to go to medical school. So every day while his students were working by themselves on some project, Mr. Dobbins would take this mysterious book out of his desk and he'd pour over it like it was the most wonderful, magical thing on earth. And then he'd close the book and lock it back up in his desk, and the kids were never allowed to see it. And so the kids were obviously obsessed with finding out about what was this book? What is in this book? And they all had their theories, but none of them had even gotten close enough to look at it. But one day, during lunchtime recess, Becky ended up in the classroom all by herself. And she couldn't believe her eyes when she saw that Mr. Dobbins had left the key for his desk in the lock. She couldn't resist, and before she knew it, she had the book in her hands. The title page said, Professor Somebody's Anatomy. And Becky had no idea what that meant. So she turned the pages and stopped at the first picture. It was a full-color drawing of a human figure. And Becky was so caught up in this and looking at the book and the picture that she didn't notice that Tom Sawyer had come into the classroom and saw her looking at the book. And when Becky did see him, it startled her, and she quick tried to close the book, but when she did, she tore the pictured page in half, right down the middle. And then, just in a panic, she shoved the book back in the drawer and locked it up and just started bawling. And then she said, Tom Sawyer, you are just as mean as you could be to sneak up on a person and look at what they're looking at. And Tom said, how can I know you was looking at anything? Becky said, you ought to be ashamed of yourself, Tom Sawyer. You know that you're going to tell on me. And what shall I do? What shall I do? I'll be whipped. And I was never whipped in school. And she ran out of the classroom with a new explosion of crying. Well, once lunchtime was over, and when class time started up again, Mark Twain tells us what happened next. A whole hour drifted by. The teacher sat nodding in his throne. The air was drowsy with the hum of study. By and by, Mr. Dobbins straightened himself up, yawned, then unlocked his desk and reached for his book. But for a moment seemed undecided whether to take it out or leave it. Most of the pupils glanced up lazily, but there were two among them that watched his movements with intent eyes. Mr. Dobbins fingered his book absently for a while, then took it out, settled himself in his chair to read. Tom shot a glance at Becky. He had seen a hunted and helpless rabbit look as she did, with a gun leveled at its head. Instantly, he forgot his quarrel with her. Quick, something must be done. Done in a flash, too, but the very imminence of the emergency paralyzed his invention. Good, he had an inspiration. He would run and snatch the book, spring through the door and fly. But his resolution shook for one little instant, and the chance was lost. The teacher opened the book. If only Tom had the wasted opportunity back again. Too late. There was no help for Becky now. The next moment, the teacher faced the school. Every eye sank under his gaze, which smote even the innocent with fear. There was silence while one might count to 10. The teacher was gathering his wrath. Then he spoke. Who tore this book? There was not a sound. One could have heard a pin drop. The stillness continued. The teacher searched face after face for signs of guilt. Benjamin Rogers, did you tear this book? A denial. Another pause. Joseph Harper, did you? Another denial. Tom's uneasiness grew more and more intense under the slow torture of these proceedings. The master scanned the ranks of boys, considered a while, then turned to the girls. Amy Lawrence, a shake of the head. Gracie Miller, the same thing. Susan Harper, did you do this? Another negative. The next girl was Becky Thatcher. Tom was trembling from head to foot with excitement and a sense of the hopelessness of the situation. Rebecca Thatcher, Tom glanced at her face. It was white with terror. Did you tear? No. Look me in the face. Did you tear this book? A thought shot like lightning through Tom's brain. He sprang to his feet and shouted, "I done it!" And the whole school stared in perplexity at this incredible foolishness. Tom stood a moment to gather his dismembered faculties, and when he stepped forward to go to his punishment, the surprise, the gratitude, the adoration that shone upon him out of poor Becky's eyes seemed to pay enough for 100 floggings. Inspired by the splendor of his own act, Tom Sawyer took the most merciless flaying that even Mr. Dobbins had ever administered, without saying a word. And when God poured out his wrath against the sins of the world, Jesus sprang to his feet and roared, "I done it." And his innocent servant body carried all our sins to the cross so that we would be rid of sin and free to live the right way, so that we would be named as a child of God and kept forever by the shepherd of our souls. Jesus' great faithfulness in the face of such terrible suffering resulted in a marvelous salvation for you and me. A salvation that's so marvelous that all the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. Or as the New Testament put it, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Just like David said in Psalm 22, he has done it. Another author put it like this: with hands nailed open, Jesus invited God, "Treat me as you would treat them." And God did. In an act that broke the heart of the Father, yet honored the holiness of heaven, sin-purging judgment flowed over the sinless Son of the ages. And heaven gave earth her finest gift, the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why did Jesus scream those words? Well, when you get right down to the bottom of it all, the reason that Jesus screamed that, the reason that Jesus screamed, my God, why have you forsaken me? Is so that you will never have to. Because of everything that Jesus Christ has done, you will never have to say that. Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for showing us through this psalm who Jesus is, and that we are part of those future generations that King David wrote about, who now, all these centuries later, are praising you for what you've done when you sent Jesus to be our suffering and faithful Savior. We thank you, Father, for what Jesus did for us on the cross, and we pray that we would respond to you like Becky Thatcher did to Tom Sawyer, that we would respond to you with surprise and gratitude and adoration. And we also ask that you would help us to live as people who truly know that we are your children, Father, and that there's nothing that will ever change that. For we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, I'm Pastor Doug, and I want to take a minute and say thank you for watching the worship service today. If you'd like to extend your time of worship, we have a couple links to worship songs that fit today's message in the description down below. Simply click, and you can spend more time with Jesus in your day today. I have three quick thoughts that I wanted to share with you, and it'll only take a minute. First, we'd love to connect with you. If you'd be willing, you can visit our website at triumphlbc.org/connect and let us know how we can reach you. Or you can visit triumphlbc.org/events to find an activity that you could jump into. Second, we hope that you see this content as a supplement to your walk with Jesus. Our digital content really isn't designed to replace belonging and engaging with a gospel community. So whether that's here at Triumph or at another church, we invite you to find a community that you can connect with. And third, we invest a lot of resources into producing content that's used to bless people just like you all over our community. If this or any of the other resources we have here at Triumph have blessed you, would you consider giving? It's because of your generosity that we are able to continue creating and serving online.